for the nail. What would you do for the nail? I'ma go bankrupt for the nail. Decline. Swarovski crystal on the nail.
Good morning. Nail Dripping Sauce Squad. I'm up. I got my coffee. I done dropped the kids off at school. I am now on a routine to where I can put stuff, I can write stuff down and actually check it off and actually get things done. So I'm excited. I'm getting my coffee, get me a grapefruit, and we are going to finish up chapter 5. I will meet you guys downstairs. Let's go.
The best part of waking up is Folgers in your cup.
I love coffee. No minding time. It's so wrong. Yep, I got my Mr. Coffee going, making my coffee. And yep, no Keurig. Old traditional coffee maker. No Keurig. Oh, y'all want to know me? Here I come. I'm coming. I'm just trying to get some coffee. That's all. I'm just trying to get my coffee. I'm getting my cup. I'm going to pour my coffee. And I'll see y'all downstairs. This is some good coffee, y'all. I know. I'm coming. I have to taste my coffee. I have to put sugar in it. I don't use creamer, but I'm coming. I promise. I'm coming. I just was tasting my coffee. Oh, is you ready? You got your stuff? I'm coming. I'm just running to Walmart, y'all. And I promise I'm going to be ready. I promise I'm gonna be ready when I get back. I just need to go get some incense, you know, and make the vibe all good and stuff. And so when I'm ready to record, it can be a nice feng shui. You know what I'm saying? So I'm just running to Walmart. I'm coming up. I'm coming. You want a ride? I'll be back. Just Walmart. That's all. About 5 minutes. 5 minutes. All right.
Was I not on time?
No, I was not. But it was 5 minutes. I'm trying to buckle my seatbelt. Okay, I'm ready. We're going straight downstairs when I get home. Straight downstairs. Okay.
Why you keep talking to me about that? I was not in there long. I was not in there long at all. Look, we are almost at the house. You so ready. I mean, can we just enjoy the moment?
Girl, I came with you.
We are almost at the house. We almost at the house.
I know what I said.
Oh, can't even go out and get no little 5 minute sunshine. Can't even get no coffee.
You tripping.
Look, we're here. We are here.
I'm coming.
All right, y'all. I'm finally ready. I'm downstairs. I got my incense lit. I am ready to go ahead and finish chapter 2. So hopefully everyone is caught up to where I am caught up. We are still in chapter 5, infection control, principles and practice, and we are on immunity. Immunity should be on page Well, I don't have the page, but just go to chapter 5 and scroll down till you see immunity. Okay? Immunity is the ability of the body to destroy and resist infection. Immunity against disease can be either natural or acquired and is a sign of good health. Natural immunity is partly inherited and partially developed through healthy living. Acquired immunity is immunity that the body develops after overcoming a disease through inoculation or through exposure to natural allergens such as pollen, cat dander, and ragweed. Principles of prevention. Proper infection control can prevent the spread of disease caused by exposure to potentially infectious material on an item's surface. Infection control also will prevent exposure to blood, invisible debris, or residues such as dust, hair, and skin. Proper infection control requires two steps. Cleaning. Remember I said at first you have to clean, then disinfect. Cleaning and then disinfecting with an appropriate EPA registered disinfectant. When these two steps are followed correctly, virtually all pathogens of concern in the salon can be effectively eliminated. Sterilization, which is the process that destroys all microbial life, is a method that can be incorporated but is very rarely mandated. Effective sterilization typically requires the use of autoclaves to complete. This piece of equipment incorporates heat and pressure. For sterilization to be effective, items must be small enough to fit into the autoclave chamber. Pre-cleaned beforehand, and the autoclave must be tested and maintained per the manufacturer's specifications. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention requires that autoclaves be tested weekly to ensure they are properly sterilizing implements. The accepted method is called a spore test. Sealed packages containing test organisms are subject to typical sterilization cycle and then sent to a contract laboratory that specializes in autoclave performance testing. So y'all remember the previous, we were still in chapter 5, but I was saying how you must clean the dirt and debris off before you can actually disinfect it, because depending on how much dirt and stuff is built up on the implements could cause the your EPA disinfectant to not work properly. So that's all that was saying right there. And when dealing with autoclaves, just make sure the implements and items are small enough to fit in the chamber, and they are maintained by the manufacturer's specifications. Okay, so we're going to go down to cleaning. The first step of any confection control method is to clean. That is a mechanical process. Mechanical process could be scrubbing, using soap and water or detergent and water to remove all visible dirt, debris, and many disease-causing germs from tools, implements, and equipment. Proper cleaning also removes invisible debris that interferes with disinfection. Nail technicians are required to clean before they disinfect. When a surface is properly cleaned, the number of contaminants on the surface is greatly reduced. As in the risk of infection, the vast majority of contaminants and pathogens can be washed from the surface of the tools and implements through proper cleaning. A surface must be properly cleaned before it can be properly disinfected. See, this is why cleaning is as important part of disinfecting nail tools and equipment. Using a disinfectant without cleaning first is likely using mouthwash without brushing your teeth. It just does not work properly. Cleaned surfaces can still harbor small amounts of pathogens, but the fewer there are, the less likely they can spread infections. Putting antiseptics on your skin will drastically lower the number of pathogens on your hand, but it will not clean your hand nor remove residual contaminants such as monomer or UV gel. So that's just like you always use a hand sanitizer. No matter what you eat, no matter what you touch, you always use a hand sanitizer instead of actually scrubbing and washing your hands. Yes, the hand sanitizer is going to sanitize the hands, probably not as good, but compared to you actually washing using a mechanical process, as they say, scrubbing, you are actually reducing the number of pathogens and germs and bacteria on your hand. Okay. The proper cleaning of hands requires liquid soap, running water, a nail brush, and a clean towel. Do not underestimate the importance of proper cleaning and hand washing. There are most powerful and important ways to prevent the spread of infection. Some common methods of cleaning in a salon include washing with soap and water and scrubbing with a clean and properly disinfected brush, using an ultrasonic unit, using a clean solvent, and disinfecting. The second step of infection control is disinfecting. Disinfection is the chemical process that uses specific products to destroy organisms on non-porous surfaces. This process requires the use of an EPA-registered disinfectant prepared and applied following the manufacturer's instructions. All surfaces must be cleaned prior to disinfection. The disinfecting process is not effective against bacterial spores, which is much more of an issue for hospitals when surgical procedures are performed. In the salon setting, disinfection is extremely effective and is considered to be EPA-approved method for controlling microorganisms on surfaces such as shears, nippers, and other multi-use tools and equipment and non-porous surfaces. Disinfectants are EPA-registered products used on non-spore surfaces that destroy microorganisms such as bacteria, virus, and fungi when used according to the disinfectant label instructions. Disinfectants are not for use on human skin, hair, or nails. Never use disinfectants as hand cleaners since they can cause skin irritations and or allergy. All disinfectants clearly state on the label to avoid skin contact. This means avoid contact with your skin as well as the clients. That's why I say when you're cleaning and sanitizing your tools, always, always, always wear gloves. Safety gloves, put on your eye protecting wear, just in case anything might splash in your eye. Do not put your fingers directly into any disinfecting solution. These are pathogen pesticides that can be harmful to the skin if not properly used. If you mix a disinfectant in a container that is not labeled by the manufacturer, it must be properly labeled with the contents and the date mixed. So that's just, I guess it's just like saying if you go get a container and you mix the solution, it might not have what you mix, it might not have that label on it. You have to properly label it and you have to put the date that you mixed it. Okay. Sterilization. A second method of infection control is cleaning and then sterilizing. The word sterilize is often used incorrectly. Sterilization is the process that completely destroys all microbial life, including spores. Microbial life, including spores. The most effective methods of sterilization use high-pressure steam autoclaves, simply exposing instruments to steam is not enough to be effective against spores and certain disease-causing pathogens. The steam must be pressurized in an autoclave. Dry heat forms of sterilization and less efficient and require longer times at higher temperatures but still can be used in the salon. Sterilization is not useful for many items in the salon setting. Pedicures, basins, countertops, you cannot put those in an autoclave. doorknobs or anything else that won't fit inside a relatively small autoclave. Therefore, it can never replace disinfection in salons. Training for the use of autoclaves can be found by searching the internet and from the manufacturers of autoclaves. For example, dirty implements. Y'all, please, I don't know if y'all can hear that noise or not, but please excuse it. The kids are home, and they are Macarena, and, oh, my Lord, help me. Won't nobody let me be great. For example, dirty implements cannot be properly sterilized without pre-cleaning. Autoclaves need regular maintenance and testing to ensure they are in good working order and performing properly. Color indicator strips on autoclave bags can provide false readings, so you should never rely solely on these to ensure proper sterility. I don't know. Autoclaves offer complete destruction of all organisms, which is an advantage over liquid disinfectants. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention requires that autoclaves be tested weekly to ensure they are properly sterilizing implements. The accepted method is called a spore test. Sealed packages containing containing test organisms are subject to a typical sterilization cycle and then sent to a contract laboratory that specializes in autoclave performance testing. You can find laboratories to perform this type of test by simply doing an internet search for autoclave spore testing. Nail techs can obtain self-spore testing vials or mail-in spore testing kits. Other regular maintenance is also required to ensure that the autoclave matches the proper temperature and pressure. Salons should always follow manufacturers' recommended schedule for cleaning, changing the water, service visits, replacement ports, etc. Be sure to keep a logbook of all usage, testing, and maintenance for the state board to inspect. Showing your logbook to clients can provide them with the peace of mind and confidence in your ability to protect them from infection. Salons that are not prepared to meet each of these requirements should not invest in or utilize an autoclave. Those salons should instead rely on the proper use of a salon disinfectant. Read labels carefully. Manufacturers take great care to develop highly effective disinfection systems. However, disinfectants can be potentially harmful and are rendered ineffectively when used improperly. If you do not follow proper guidelines and instructions, any professional saline product can be potentially dangerous. Like all products, disinfectants must always use exactly as the label dictates. If used improperly, disinfectants cannot be expected to perform properly and will not protect you or your clients. Okay, now it's talking about choosing a disinfectant. If you guys don't have a disinfectant, maybe this will give you some ideas of what you can use. I get my disinfectant from a local beauty supply store, which is, like I said before, Barberside. It is professional, hospital-grade disinfectant. It kills viruses, fungal. It kills HIV, AIDS, and things in that sort. Hopefully I can get a little smaller video of me maybe cleaning my tools and showing you my Barberside. And maybe we can mix it or something. I don't know. Might be a whole nother video. To use a disinfectant properly, you must read and follow the manufacturer's instructions. Mixing ratios, dilution, and contact time are very important. Not all disinfectants are mixed to the same concentration. So be sure to mix the correct amount according to the instructions on the label. If the label does not have the amount according to the instructions on the label, if the label does not have the word concentrated on it, the product is already pre-mixed and must be used as is. All EPA registered disinfectants, even those sprayed on large surfaces, will specify a contact time and their direction for use. Contact time is the amount of time the surface must remain wet with the disinfectant in order for the disinfectant to be effective. So you can't just spray the disinfectant and then automatically start wiping. No, it should give you a contact time, like I said, that the implements or what have you must be wet without you touching and scrubbing or rubbing it. Disinfectants must have efficacy claims on the label. Efficacy is the ability to produce an effect. As applied to disinfectant claims, efficacy is the effectiveness with which a disinfectant solution kills specific organisms when used accordingly to the label instructions. Salons pose a much lower infection risk when compared to hospitals. Cleaning and disinfection standards are much more stricter in hospitals than in salons, as it should be, and for good reasons. Some types of disinfectants are much too dangerous for use in the salon environment, especially since the risk of causing serious infections is low. Even so, there is a risk of spreading certain types of infections to nail clients. Therefore, it is important to always clean and disinfect correctly. Fortunately, any EPA-registered liquid hospital disinfectant will be effective enough for salons. For this reason, when salon implements accidentally come into contact with blood, bodily fluids, or unhealthy conditions, they should be cleaned and then completely immersed in a liquid EPA-registered hospital disinfectant solution that shows effectiveness against HIV, hepatitis, or tuberculosis. Of course, you should wear gloves and follow the proper standard precautions protocol for cleaning exposure incidents, which is described later in the chapter. I told y'all this was a lot. But we're almost done. Disinfectants for large surfaces. Some surfaces are too large to completely immerse in an EPA-registered disinfectant. A wide range of disinfecting surface cleaners is available for use on countertops, arm, foot, wrist, door handles, etc. Always follow the manufacturer's directions. Excuse me, and heed all precautions when using any disinfectant, including those designed for cleaning and disinfecting large surfaces. Typically, instructions may be to spray the surface and wipe the surface clean. Spray again and allow the surface to remain wet for time specified by the product's label and wipe dry. It is important to note that none of these work instantly and typically require 5 to 10 minutes to be effective. Proper use of disinfectants. All implements must be thoroughly cleaned and all visible matter or residue before soaking in disinfectant solution. Because residue can interfere with the disinfectant and prevent proper disinfection, properly cleaned implements and tools free from all visible debris must be completely immersed in disinfectant solution. Complete immersion means there is enough liquid in the container to cover all surfaces of the item being disinfected, including the handles, for at least 10 minutes or according to the manufacturer's directions, which you see in figure 513 is showing you those sterilizing jars or whatever, disinfecting jars. And they are large, they have the liquid large enough to put all of their implements in, and it's completely immersed in the disinfectant solution. Okay? Got some cautions right there. Disinfectants must be registered with the EPA. Look for EPA registration number on the label. Disinfectant tips: use only on pre-cleaned, hard, non-porous surfaces, not disposable, single-use abrasive files or buffers. may be used on implements such as abrasive files made of metal, glass, and ceramic, or indicated in the manufacturer's direction that the file is designed for multiple uses. Read the manufacturer's directions and follow them carefully. Like, I went to Sally's, and I had got some files, and they were washable, and you could disinfect them. So those type of files are okay. But, like, the regular throwaway files, you cannot disinfect those because it says non-porous, in which the files are porous and the buffers are porous. Always wear gloves and safety glasses when handling disinfectant solutions. We said that. Always dilute products according to the instructions on the label. A contact time of 10 minutes is required unless the product label specifies differently. To disinfect large surfaces such as countertops, carefully apply disinfectant onto the pre-cleaned surface and allow it to remain wet for 10 minutes, unless the product label specifies differently. Number 6, the entire implement, including the handles, must be completely immersed in the solution. Change the disinfectant according to the instructions on the label. If the disinfectant is not changed as instructed, it will no longer be effective and may begin to promote the growth of pathogens. Proper disinfection of a whirlpool, pipeless, or air jet pedicure spa requires that disinfectant solution circulate for 10 minutes unless the product label specifies otherwise. Okay, types of disinfectants. Disinfectants are not all the same. Some are appropriate for use in the salon and some are not. You should be aware of the different types of disinfectants and those that are recommended for salon use. Quats. Also known as quats, are disinfectants that are very effective when used properly in the salon. The most advanced type of these formulations are called multiple quats. They contain sophisticated blends of quats that work together to dramatically increase the effectiveness of these disinfectants. Sorry, y'all gotta get a drink of water. Multiple quad solutions usually disinfect implements in 10 minutes. These formulas may contain anti-rust ingredients. However, leaving tools in the solution for prolonged periods can cause dulling or damage. They should be removed from the solution after the specified period. Rinse it if required, dry it, and store it in a clean covered container. Phenolic. I don't know, y'all. Y'all know. Phenolic disinfectants are powerful tuberculosal disinfectants. Those have a very high pH and can cause damage to the skin and eyes. Some can be harmful to the environment if put down the drain. Those disinfectants have been used reliably over the years to disinfect salon tools. However, they do not have other drawbacks. Those can damage plastic and rubber and can cause certain metals to rust. Those disinfectants should never be used to disinfect pedicure tubs or equipment. Extra care should be taken to avoid skin contact with those disinfectants. Okay, household bleach. Everybody should have some household bleach. Household bleach, 5.25% sodium hypochlorite, is an effective disinfectant for all uses in the salon. So if y'all run out of disinfectant, y'all, we could use bleach. I didn't know that. Bleach has been used extensively as a disinfectant. Using too much bleach can damage some metals and plastics, so be sure to read the label for safe use. Bleach can be corrosive to metals and plastics and can cause skin irritation and eye damage. To mix bleach solution, always follow the manufacturer's directions. Disinfectants should be mixed fresh daily, not stored. Disinfect safely. Disinfectants are classified by the EPA as pesticides for pathogens and may cause serious skin and eye damage. Some disinfectants appear clear, while others are a little cloudy, especially those disinfectants. Always use caution when handling disinfectants. Avoid skin and eye contact and follow the following safety tips. See that girl right there? She got on gloves and her eyewear. So she ready. She ready. Safety tips for disinfectants. Always refer to the disinfectant SDS safety data sheet and instruction label before use to ensure safety handling and correct use. Always wear gloves and safety glasses. Y'all know they keep going over that because they can't stress how important it is. Always wear gloves and safety glasses when mixing disinfectants. Always avoid skin and eye contact. Always add a disinfectant to water, not water to a disinfectant, to prevent foaming, which can result in incorrect mixing ratio. Water should be room temperature or cool, never hot. Always use tongs or gloves to remove implements from disinfectants and use a draining basket for rinsing multiple items at the same time. Always keep disinfectants out of the reach of children. Always carefully measure and use disinfectant products according to label instructions. Always follow the manufacturer instructions for mixing, using, and properly disposing of disinfectants. Always carefully follow the manufacturer instructions regarding when to replace the disinfectant solution in order to ensure the healthiest conditions for you and your client. Replace the disinfectant solution every day, and more often if the solution becomes soiled or contaminated. Y'all ready? Never pre-mix large amounts of disinfectants. Mixing them freshly on a daily basis is best. Never guess or estimate the amount of disinfectant to mix. Always carefully measure before mixing. Never let quartz, that word, bleach, or any other disinfectants come into contact with your skin. If you do get disinfectants on your skin, immediately wash your hands with liquid soap and warm water. Then rinse the area and dry thoroughly. Never place any disinfectant or other products in an unmarked container. Drawers or containers used to disinfect implements are often incorrectly called wet sanitizers. Let me read that again because it just went in my mouth and came out. Drawers or containers used to disinfect implements are often incorrectly called wet sanitizers. Okay. The purpose of these containers is to hold a disinfectant solution, not to clean. Disinfect containers must be covered but not airtight. Remember to clean the container every day and to wear gloves. Always follow the manufacturer's instructions for disinfecting products. Disinfect or dispose. How can you tell which items in the salon can be disinfected and used more than once? There are two types of items used in salons: multi-use or reusable and single-use or disposable. If the process of cleaning and disinfecting damages the item or changes its condition, it is a single-use item. Multi-use or reusable items can be cleaned, disinfected, and used more than once. more than one person, even if the item is accidentally exposed to blood or bodily fluids. Example of multi-use items are towels, nippers, shears, pushers, some type of nail files, bits, and buffers. Always check with the product manufacturer if you are unsure if an item can be properly disinfected. Porous described as an item that is made or constructed of a material that has pores or openings that allow liquid to be absorbed. Some porous items can be safely cleaned, disinfected, and used more than once on a client. Examples are towels, linen, and some nail files and buffers. An example of a porous item that cannot be properly disinfected is a pumice type abrasive for callus. Now, y'all remember last video when we was reading, still on chapter 5, when they said an improperly cleaned pumice stone when that lady got her feet done and she died from that heart attack. Now, didn't I say that I thought pumice stones was only used once, one time on one person and then thrown away? So I think that's giving us clarity that, yes, pumice stones are only supposed to be used one time. Y'all, I'm loving this chapter. I am really learning. It's giving me energy. It's making me think. It's very important. So I hope y'all having fun with me. Stay with me. Hit the like button. Hit the like button. Hit the like button. Okay. Where was we? Okay, an example. Let's read that again. An example of a porous item that cannot be properly disinfected is a pumice-type abrasive for calluses. This should not be used in salons since it cannot be properly cleaned, disinfected between clients. If a porous item contacts broken skin, blood, body fluid, or any unhealthy condition, it must be discarded immediately. Do not try to disinfect it if you are not sure whether an item can be safely cleaned, disinfected, and used again. Throw it out. Remember, when in doubt, throw it out. Single-use or disposable items cannot be used more than once, either because they cannot be properly cleaned so that all visible residue is removed, such as pumice stones used for pedicures, or because cleaning and disinfecting damages or contaminates them. Example of disposable items are wooden sticks, cotton balls, sponges, gauze, tissue, paper towels, pumice stones, and some nail files and buffers. Single-use or disposable items must be thrown out after use. Keep a logbook. Now, I do clean and I disinfect my tools. I was at first, I got a little label maker, and I would write what day that it got cleaned on, and I stopped writing the day that it got cleaned. But I do need to give me a logbook. I ain't even gonna lie, and I ain't even gonna stunt. I stopped writing down the dates. I still was cleaning them and disinfecting them every day, but I wasn't keeping a logbook on how. Because sometimes if you clean someone's time and if you don't use it, you don't have to clean it every day. Sometimes certain things might, depending on how you use it, might get cleaned once a week or however. Let's keep reading, though. Salons should always follow the manufacturer's recommended schedule for cleaning and disinfecting tools and implements. Okay, and let me say this. I'm not saying what I'm doing is right, because I'm learning just like y'all learning. I'm learning as we're talking right now. So don't try to be in my comments coming at me. And I'm new to this too. So, yeah. Disinfecting foot spas and basins. Scheduling regular service visits for equipment and replacing parts when needed. Although your state may not require that you keep a logbook of all equipment usage, cleaning, disinfecting, testing, and maintenance, it may be advisable to keep one. Showing your logbook to clients provides them with peace of mind and confidence in your ability to protect them from infection and disease. Disinfection procedures, tools, and implements. Tools and implements must be cleaned and disinfected after each time they are used and before they may be used on another client. Be certain to dilute and mix disinfectants according to the label on the product that you choose. Mix disinfectants according to the manufacturer's directions, always adding disinfectant to the water. So you see, figure 5-16, they are adding the disinfectant to the water, not the water to the disinfectant solution. You see, she still got on her gloves. That little white sterilizing tray thing, I have one of those. And that's how I clean my tools. I do not have big tools. I just have things such as nippers, cuticle pushers, small scissors. I have like little tweezer type implements and my bits and things in that sort. Okay, now let's get to towels and linen. Clean towels and linens must be used for each client. After a towel or linen has been used on a client, it must not be used again until it has been properly laundered. Store solid linens and towels separately from clean linen and towels in covered or closed containers. You should store clean towels in covered or closed containers even if your state regulatory agency does not require it. Whenever possible, use disposable paper towels, especially in restrooms. Work surfaces. Before beginning a service for each client, all work surfaces must be cleaned and disinfected. It is not necessary to disinfect tables and chairs unless the customer touched them with their skin. But for me, I just clean it anyway. I just clean it anyway because you never know. You can never be too safe or too sure. Chairs, unless the customers touch them with their skin, but they certainly need to be cleaned regularly. Clean doorknobs, phone receivers, and other handles that are used on a regular basis daily to reduce transferring germs to your hand. Also, with the seasons changing, depending on where you live, I know the flu bug is going around, and because of the seasons changing, so a lot of people are getting their flu shots and stuff like that. So that is another way to protect yourself. If you might have a client that's sick and is coming in and coughing and stuff like that, you having that flu shot or any type of vaccine will protect you. And you also just cleaning and wiping down your surface, even if they haven't touched it or even if they have. It's just a safeguard. Individual client plaques for nail services. Some states do not allow technicians to save a client pack with items such as nail files and buffers. This is because clients can become infected by their own implements. For example, bacteria commonly found on the skin in lower concentrations can multiply to high concentrations during storage and could cause an infection during the next service. Therefore, you must follow these steps to protect clients if your state allows client packs. 1. Each item must be properly cleaned, disinfected, and dried before use. Even if it's being used on the same client, if clients bring their own implements to the salon, they must be cleaned and disinfected before they can be used in order to prevent pathogens from contaminating other items in the salon. Each item must be properly cleaned, disinfected, and dried before placed in the client's pack in order to prevent contamination of the storage pack. Never store single-use items in client packs between services. Instead, use new single-use items during the service and then dispose of them. Never use bags or containers with an airtight seal to store tools or implements. These provide an environment that encourages the growth of bacteria or other pathogens. If the item is not properly cleaned, disinfected, and dried thoroughly before being stored, remember, state rules require that all tools and equipment must be cleaned and disinfected before each use, even if they are used on the same person. Okay? Even if a client insists on bringing his or her tools to the salon, you must clean and disinfect them for 10 minutes or as specified by the disinfectant manufacturer's label before you use them. For this reason, it is not recommended that clients be allowed to bring their own implements. Home implements can be harboring infectious organisms, contaminate other items in the salon. Especially since some clients use the same.
Hold on, y'all.
Home implements can be harboring infectious organisms and contaminate other items in the salon. Especially since some clients use these same implements on their entire family and sometimes even on pets. Ew. Remember, it is your license that is at risk if there is a problem. Even if your client brings her tools with her, this is very risky practice. Should be discouraged for the safety of all who visit the salon. Okay, y'all. We are going to get right here when it's talking about I'm going to beat they butts. Do y'all hear that? I don't know if y'all hear that or not, but I keep telling, they are upstairs acting like a stampede. Hold on. All right. Disinfecting foot spas and pedicure equipment. All equipment that contains water for pedicures, including whirlpool spas, pipeless units, foot baths, basins, tubs, sinks, and bowls, must be cleaned and disinfected after every pedicure, and the information must be entered into a logbook. Inspectors may issue fines if there is no logbook, and potential new clients may leave the salon. Detergents and soap. Chelatin or chelating detergents are especially designed to break down stubborn films and are very important for removing the residue of pedicure products such as scrubs, salt, and masks. These chelating agents in detergents work in all types of water or low sodizing and specially formulated to work in areas with hard tap water. Which reduces the effectiveness of cleaners and disinfectants. Hard water is more likely to create difficult to remove residue on surfaces and inside pipes. Check with your local distributor for pedicure cleaners that are effective in hard water. This will be stated on the label. Additives, powders, and tablets. There is no additive, powder, or tablet that eliminates the need for you to clean and disinfect. There is no shortcut to properly cleaning and disinfection, and no replacement for EPA registered liquids disinfectant solutions. Water sanitizers, for example, sanitizing tablets or other similar, do not properly clean or disinfect equipment. They're designed for jacuzzis and hydrotherapy tubs where no oils, lotions, etc. are used, so they don't work properly with salon equipment. Never rely solely on water sanitizer additives to protect your client. Products that contain chloramine, tea for example, are not effective disinfectants for any type of salon equipment. These products do not replace proper cleaning and disinfectant and provide little to no protection for clients. There's also a caution right there for those of you who do have the pedicure spas. I do want one. I don't have one yet. Right now, I do use a foot basin. Dispensary. The dispensary must be kept clean and orderly with the contents of all containers clearly marked. Always store products according to the manufacturer's instructions away from heat out of direct sunlight. Federal law requires that the salon keep safety data sheets for all products used in the salon. Handling disposable supplies. All disposable supplies such as wooden sticks, cotton gauze, nail wipes, single-use nail files, and paper towels should be stored in a manner to prevent pre-service contamination and thrown away after one use. Anything exposed to blood must be placed in a basket and marked with biohazard stickers or disposed of according to OSHA standards, which is separate from any other waste. So like when we go in the doctors, y'all see the little orange sticker that shows biohazard use. Anytime they give someone a shot or any like bleeding type of things that they use, that's bodily fluids and stuff like that, they put in the biohazard, different from any regular trash. Okay, hand washing. Washing your hands is one of the most important actions you can take to prevent the spread of pathogens from one person to another. Hand washing removes pathogens from the folds and grooves of the skin and from under the free edge of the nail plate by lifting and rinsing them from the surface. In the salon, both your hands and your client's hands should be thoroughly washed with soap and warm water before each service. Never perform a service without asking clients to first wash their hands and be sure to provide them with a clean, disinfected nail brush. Medical studies suggest that antimicrobial and antibacterial soaps are no more effective than regular hand soaps or detergents. Using a moisturizer hand lotion can prevent dry skin, which can be caused by repeated hand washing. When washing hands, use a liquid soap in a pump container. Bar soaps can grow bacteria. Avoid using very hot water since this can damage the skin. For your protection, be sure to wash your hands thoroughly after you have completed the service. And if you see, as y'all can see, it tells you Procedure 5-3, it'll tell you what page to go to for proper hand washing, or Procedure 5-2, clean, disinfecting foot spas or bathrooms, go to page 90. Okay, waterless hand sanitizers, antiseptics, or chemical germicides registered and regulated by the FDA that are formulated for use on skin, and acceptance can contain either alcohol or that word. Which is less drying than alcohol. Neither type can clean the hands of dirt and debris. This can only be accomplished with liquid soap, a soft bristle brush, and water. When washing hands, use liquid soap in pump containers. Bar soap can grow bacteria. Use hand sanitizers only after proper cleaning your hands and never use an antiseptic to disinfect instruments or other surfaces since they are not effective for that purpose. Standard precautions. The Center for Disease Control has published guidelines called the Standard Precautions that require the employee and the employee to assume that all human blood and body fluids are infectious for blood-borne pathogens. Because it is impossible to identify many clients with infectious disease, the same infection control practices should be used with all clients in most instances. Clients who are infected with the hepatitis B virus or other blood-borne pathogens are asymptomatic, which means that they show no symptom or sign of infection. Blood-borne pathogens are more difficult to kill than those that live outside the body. OSHA sets safety standards and precautions that protect employees when they are potentially exposed to blood-borne pathogens. Exposure to blood-borne and other pathogens can occur in the salon. Nail technicians may potentially be exposed to blood-borne pathogens when exposed to blood or bodily fluid, potentially be exposed to airborne pathogens through the illness of the client or co-worker, or pathogens that may potentially be released if foully infected nails. Potentially exposed their eyes to debris during filing or trimming of the nails. For these reasons, nail technicians must wear gloves when working with clients, dust masks when filing, electronic or hand filing, and protective eyewear when filing, electronic or hand filing. Precautions include washing hands, wearing gloves whenever there is a potential for blood exposure, and properly handling and disposal of sharp instruments and items that have been contaminated by blood or other bodily fluids. It is important that specific procedures are followed if blood and bodily fluid is present. Okay, here is what to do if you have an exposure incident and you get in contact with blood or bodily fluid. Accidents happen. An exposure incident, previously called blood spill, is contact with a non-intact skin, blood, or body fluid, or other potential infectious materials that result from the performance of an employee's duties. Should this occur, follow the steps outlined in Procedure 5-4. Okay, so, I mean, all of it is right here. If you ever get in contact, you nip the skin and start bleeding, it'll tell you what all you need to do. The professional saline image. Infection control practices should be a part of your normal routine as well as for those who work with you. This way, you and your coworkers can project a steady, fast professional image. The following are some simple guidelines that will keep the salon looking its best. Number one, keep floors, workstations dust-free. Mop, vacuum every day. Keep trash in a waste basket. Reduce chemical odors and fires. Clean fans and humidifiers at least once a week. Keep the ceiling and wall vents clean and free from dust, which can blow from dirty vents and escape into the salon. Ventilation dust should be thoroughly cleaned on a yearly basis. Keep all work areas well lit. Keep restrooms, including door handles, clean. Provide toilet tissue, paper towels, liquid soap. Properly disinfect the soft bristle nail brushes and a container for use brushes in the restroom. Do not allow salon to be used for cooking or living quarters. Never place food in the same refrigerator used to store salon products. Prohibit eating, drinking, and smoking in areas where services are performed or where product mixing occurs. Empty waste receptacles regularly throughout the day. A metal waste basket receptacle with a self-closing lid works best to control vapors and prevent accidental fires. Make sure all containers are properly marked and stored. Never place any tools or implements in your mouth or pockets. Properly clean and disinfect all tools before reuse, including implements brought into the salon by a client. Store clean and disinfectant tools in a clean covered container. Clean drawers may be used for storage if only clean items are stored in them. Always isolate used dirty implements from disinfected implements. Avoid touching your face, mouth, or eyes during service. Clean and disinfect all work surfaces after every client. This includes manicure tables, workstations, and pedicure foot spas and basins. Have clean disposable paper towels available for each client. Always properly wash your hands before and after each service. Never provide a nail service to a client who have not properly washed their hands and carefully scrubbed under their nails with a disinfectant nail brush. Use effective exhaust systems in the salon. Replacing the air in the salon with fresh air at least 4 times every hour is the recommended minimum, not maximum. This will help ensure proper air quality in the salon. Your professional responsibility. Y'all still with me? You have many responsibilities as a salon professional, but none is more important than protecting your client's health and safety. Never take shortcuts for cleaning and disinfection. You cannot afford to skip steps or save money when it comes to safety. Remember, it is your professional and legal responsibility to follow state laws and rules. Keep your license current and notify the license agency if you move or change your name. Check the state website regularly, monthly, for example, for any changes to the rules. Okay, y'all. This is going, and it's going to show different type of procedures for cleaning and disinfecting non-electrical tools and equipment. Like I said, this is going to be a whole nother video because I will actually be demonstrating. I'm going to use my foot basin, and I'm going to use my tools and implements, and we're going to clean them and disinfect them, and we're going to follow just as they say. We're going to read the labels to the disinfectant that I use, and we are going to do it tit for tat, not skipping, not missing anything, and I'm going to get me a logbook, probably go to the dollar store and get some type of book book that I can log my cleaning in. So yeah, it goes all the way down to pipeless foot spas, whirlpools, foot baths and tubs, proper hand washing. We all should know proper hand washing. If not, it's right there in the book, y'all. It's right there in the book. Okay. So, and like I said, review questions and then on to chapter 6. But that's all I have for you today. Thank y'all so much. Thank you so much for continuing this journey with me. Nobody said, the road is easy, but I'm traveling it. I'm traveling. I might fall. I might get a little bruise. But hey, I'm getting back up, and I'm going to keep on chucking and jiving. If there's something you want to do, don't give up. And that's with anything. That's with anything. Do not give up. It might be obstacles in the way, but you just need to learn how to maneuver and how maybe you might need to take a different path, but that path might still get you into the direction where you want to go. So, once again, my Nails Dripping Sauce Squad, I love y'all. I love you. I love you. I love you. If you ain't joined, what are you waiting for? Come on. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I think I got 105 subscribers. Like I said, I'm not counting. I just want to have fun. I just want to share my experience, my journey. Hopefully y'all can do the same thing with me. So go ahead. Leave us a comment. Talk to me. Hit the like button again. And thank you guys for watching.
Dipped in honey on the nail. Wrong polish, wrong color, gel nail. Yeah, I'm a cook, I'm a clean for the nail. So ratchet, make a scene for the nail.
She thirsty.
I dream big dreams for the nail. Ooh. Hell nah, send my soul for the nail. Freddy Krueger on the nail. I'm a prep for the nail.
First step,
put me a secret on the nail. Second step, skip a step for the nail. Never step.
What did you do?